anyway, until I noticed those rips in my sheets, and that was proof that there had been a nightmare on my street.
And now, welcome to the stage, opening for Laugh Track and Field, doing some stand-up comedy, Julia Dreyer!
Hello, hello! How's everyone doing? This is exciting. I only thought there were like four of you out here, so this is a lot more than that. This is awesome. This is a nice surprise. Are we ready to see some comedy? Yeah, start the Halloween weekend off right. Well, I'm ready to. So much so, I'm going to do some stand-up for you guys. Firstly, you know, I was texting my friend the other day, as we all do, because that's how we communicate with each other. And we were just talking about class and kind of having like a heated discussion about something, and I just needed to exclaim. And I was like, Jesus Christ. But my phone auto-corrected that to Jesus Christina. So how's that for modern day feminism? I was pretty pumped about it. I was like, I will save this in my dictionary and use it all the time. So I just got a job at a Starbucks, which I'm pretty excited about because I've been trying to get a job at Starbucks for years. I know that might seem pretty basic to some of you, but I'm excited. It's a big deal. It's a big job, and the job is fun. I get unlimited coffee on shift, and the people are nice. The people I work with are nice. It's just pretty great. It's casual, and I should have known because my job interview was pretty conversational and casual as well. It was just comfortable. I wanted to keep talking to my manager, and then I was able to because he hired me, so it was convenient. But after my interview, I got to thinking that a lot of job interviews, at least ones that I've done, haven't been as conversational and casual as that one was. So I was thinking, what could we do to maybe spice up the job interview life, kind of jazz it up a little bit, jazz up locations? And I was thinking, well, you know, Having this interview at Starbucks, for Starbucks, was pretty nice. Like, just go to a coffee shop, talk to your prospective boss over a cup of coffee, look over your resume, talk about the meaning of life, it'd be great. But then I kind of wanted to take it up a notch, so I was thinking Joe's Crab Shack would be awesome. Like, you sit at a table with not only your prospective boss, but the competitors for the job that you want, put on your bibs or whatever you do, have a crab claw cracking competition, and whoever could use their bare hands and get the most crab meat out, like the biggest chunks, would just get the job, and it would be great. And if you don't finish, you get like a second meal because you get to take it all home. So it's, you get some food and a job. And if you don't get the job, you still not a winner. But then I wanted to take it up even further, and I thought, man, maybe not having a group interview, maybe it would make it a little better. So having like a one-on-one dinner date type thing with your prospective boss at obviously medieval times. Like, don't just go out to dinner, go to medieval times, sit in your section, have that soup, no spoon, because it's medieval, have your half a roasted chicken, no knife or fork, because it's medieval times, obviously. So you're in it, you're feeling it, and your boss leans over, or prospective boss, because you don't technically have the job yet, leans over to you and says, hey, if the black and white knight wins, you're hired, you get the job. And that would be great, because we all know that medieval times is scripted anyways, so you basically were just given the job as you get to enjoy this entertainment. I mean, it'd be awesome. So moving on, past jobs and the other more adulthood stuff, I've seen a lot of Facebook posts lately of my friends who are getting married, having kids. It's kind of weird. Like, if any of you are married, that's awesome, and I think it's so beautiful, but I just celebrated my 2-year anniversary with my boyfriend, and I'm not even ready to take that next step. I'm perfectly content sitting at home, eating pints of ice cream, kind of pretending like we're not in a 2-year relationship. Like, I'm good with my cat and Netflix right now. But I will say, with all of these posts on Facebook of engagements or actual weddings and creeping the 535 wedding photos that have been posted already, I have been feeling a little bit left out. It's just like I said, I just celebrated this anniversary. I'm like, oh man, that actually, even though like I'm not ready, I'm kind of ready. Like, it sounds kind of nice. So I realized last week that I must be in love, because my boyfriend and I, drove to Springdale, nothing too crazy. And there's a baby store there called 9 Months Later, and it's awesome. And the sign says, "We pay cash." So I was like, great, I could just walk in, buy one of the babies that were sold just as easily as they were, pay them some cash, you know, get a baby, it all works out. It'd be great. Human trafficking is still an issue, guys. It's hilarious. So we all know Winona Ryder. She was half of the dream couple of the early 1990s, when she was briefly engaged to Johnny Depp, my one true love, before he got weird. She was also in Beetlejuice, Edward Scissorhands. Okay, she was the mom in Stranger Things. We've all seen that. I know you guys recognize Joyce Byers more than her legendary characters. And I was thinking, like, she was cast in this maybe because she was in other creepy movies back in the day, like all of these Tim Burton films. But then I was wondering, like, she has a very, very distinct voice. Like, if you watch Stranger Things and then you go back and you watch all of the other things that she's been in, you'll notice that maybe she was just kind of brought onto the show so people could really analyze and listen to her voice. Like, throughout the whole show, she's like, "Oh, Will, oh, Will, oh, just shine, just blink once for yes, oh, Will, I'm coming for you, oh." She does this thing, it's like this beautiful, like, marbly sounding voice that I, like, kind of want. And so I was thinking, like, with her whole, like, "Oh, Will, oh, I miss you, I'm your mom, and I'm working for you, oh, Will, I miss you." There's other people that could have easily been cast as her character. And, like, the first one that came to mind, obviously, was Owen Wilson. Like, Owen Wilson as Joyce Byers would have been beautiful, because instead of being like, "Oh, Will, I'm so sad and I miss you and your brother didn't take care of you and I'm gonna wait till the last episode." Spoiler alert, just kidding. Instead of that, it would be like, "Oh, wow, all of these lights, oh my God. Will, this is fantastic. This is just fantastic. Oh, wow, are you doing that? Oh, wow, that's my kid, that's my boy. That is my boy." It would be so interesting, right? Because, like, he doesn't have, like, the run-of-the-mill Matthew McConaughey voice. Like, it's Owen Wilson. He's got the voice of the gods, you know? Thanks for sitting through my impersonations, because I worked really hard on them. So. And I have one last thing for you in the spirit of Halloween. It's kind of spooky. It's been kind of on my mind for the past couple weeks, because it's this thing that happened to me just, like, on a normal, average day going to class, and it's still, like, in my head, and I want to share it with you guys because I think it fits this occasion. Like I said, I was on my way to class, just a normal day, had my cup of coffee, got in the elevator, checked my phone, just to make sure I was on time, doing my own thing. Press the button, and the elevator door's closed. It's great. Look at my phone, and all of a sudden I hear 4, I was like, what? Where did you come from? And there was this girl standing, like, pressed against the back corner of this elevator. First of all, didn't know you could demand such a common courtesy as pressing a button for your floor on an elevator, like, elevator etiquette, come on. But secondly, I would have just naturally been like, oh, hi, what floor do you need? If I had even seen her, like, she popped out of nowhere. I thought maybe I was on my phone, like, oh, maybe I just didn't see her. I wasn't on my phone, though. I was, like, ready to get to class. I was like, let's go. But then I checked my phone. So she's standing here. I'm like, oh, okay, great. Four, awesome, all right. Go back to my phone, because I still had a few floors to go. And all of a sudden, she goes, you have a cat? Yeah, I do. How did you know that? Because I thought maybe she saw my phone wallpaper, because my wallpaper is a picture of my cat. So I was like, oh, we're the only two people in this elevator. Maybe she just saw that. I can smell it on you. Okay, so you have cats too. I mean, they have kind of a unique smell, I guess, if you have a lot of them. Can you smell it on me? Well, no, I don't have that power. That's actually, that's pretty impressive. You should take that to America's Got Talent or something. I'm sure Howie would love that, honestly. But no, I don't have that. Okay, two floors to go. All right. Back to my phone. Do your cats sleep in bed with you? Do they sleep with you? Well, my one cat kind of does her thing. I don't really care. She's allowed in bed with, I don't know, cats are independent. Can't really tell them what to do. If I was your cat, could I sleep with you? I'm sorry, if you were my cat, I can be your cat. At this point, I'm like, oh, thank God, it's my floor, I'm ready to get out, let's go, doors open, it's one of those creaky elevators, taking forever. I'm like, okay, I don't know what's going on, I need to go. But the thing is, I never got off that elevator, so here we are. This is my ghost. And that's my set. Please welcome to the stage my family and team, Laugh Track and Field.
It was a graveyard smash. It caught on in a flash. It took them all from my laboratory in the castle east.
Thank you all so much for coming. We're super excited to have you guys with us at our Halloween show. I asked everybody to all wear a costume because it was Halloween, and all of them dressed up as me. So that's great. But we're going to have a great show. We're really excited about what we have for you guys here tonight. Everything you're going to see is going to be completely improvised, completely made up from off the top of our heads. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to start with a long-form set called Deconstruction. And what's going to happen is we're going to have one long scene that takes about 5 minutes. And at the end of that scene, everything else we do is going to be inspired by something that happened in the very first scene. So I need half the group up for Deconstruction. And can I get a character relationship that two characters could share? It's going to be a long night if you don't yell at me.
You're right.
I heard siblings first. Thank you. Guys, take it away, siblings.
Daryl.
Daryl Jr.
I never really understood the way Dad did the naming thing.
I don't get it.
I get to be Daryl Jr., but you're also like a side Daryl. I just kind of... Maybe because we had different moms. I don't know.
That could be vital information that could come into play in the third act.
I just... No, I'm feeling pretty down, Daryl.
What's wrong, Junior?
I really don't like it when you call me Junior, because you're not my dad. You're my half-brother. Well, anyway, my problem... Dad keeps telling...
I'm upset, okay?
Why are you... Wait, are you using... my problem and turning around and making it your problem, because you always do that in front of Dad, and it really upsets me. Boy, you're just full of them today, aren't you, Daryl?
Say anything, Daryl. See, that's why I called you Junior, because I call you Daryl, and I don't understand who... Am I talking to third person?
Nobody talks in third person, Daryl.
I know of one Mr. Bruce Banner that would like to speak with you.
Fair enough. Anyway, my problem is... Dad keeps telling me that you're the real Daryl Junior.
I am?
Don't act so happy about that.
I feel like I'm allowed to be happy about this. Like, it's really shitty for you, dude. Like...
Yeah, it's terrible for me. He's disowning me.
But you... Is he changing your name?
That's the thing, isn't it?
I assume. Would you like to tell me more?
You remember my mom, his first wife?
Not really, because she's not my mom, but I've seen pictures.
Sure, those pictures that he uses as dartboards, sure.
Wow, yeah, that's your mom?
Yeah, those ones that you participated in the dart throwing at, yeah.
Oh.
Don't act so surprised, you're the one who did it!
Listen, man, what's wrong with your mom?
Well, her name's Robert. Dad wants to call me Robert now. And I'm Daryl Jr. Robert Jefferson.
But you're still keeping the name Daryl Jr.?
He's given it to you.
Yep, but... Okay, so I get Daryl Jr.
Listen, it's gonna be complicated at school, and I wanted to prep you for that. Because, you know, we go to school with a lot of people with the same name.
We go to a school exclusively for Daryls.
Daryl Elementary School.
Do you get to keep going to school there?
Probably not. I'm going to probably get expelled. It's just the way it is.
I mean, it's written in the school constitution.
If your name's not Daryl, get the hell out.
it's a real school for hard knocks.
It's a real hard knocks. They knock you on out of there. Right out the door.
The very literal.
Very literal.
That's what they called the elementary school for Daryls. So.
You know, we should have seen that one coming.
Yeah, I feel like, in retrospect, this situation wasn't really a surprise for either of us.
You're right.
I mean, we've always been easily surprised by things.
Of course.
Like, when I found out we were half-brothers because we had different moms.
That was very surprising.
I couldn't get over it for, like... An hour.
Yeah, it took me like 15 minutes.
It's crazy.
I know, it was, wow, we're half brothers, ooh! It's a nice surprise noise, you know?
Then we hit puberty real fast.
Yeah, I was like, wow, we're half brothers, ooh.
I don't know what to tell you. Can we change your name back to Daryl Jr.?
Sure, let's just deliberately disobey Dad. It's not like he went through the school of hard knocks.
So...
Yeah, he'll kick us the hell out too.
But you'll be the only Daryl in that. You know my mom's name is Daryl, right?
Yeah, Dad really had this weird thing. It was weird.
We know. Statistically, an impossible amount of Daryls.
There are so many Daryls in this equation.
There's
I don't think it's
Daryls.
Possible. Dad like had to actively seek out like some dating website with like darylsonly.com.
Remember that guy Darrell?
Yeah, okay. I got banned, but that was... Yeah, well...
So what do you propose we do about this whole, you getting kicked out of our school thing?
You don't really seem so beat up about it. So.
Well, I'm not getting kicked out of school!
Well, maybe you'll change your name to Darrell and take one for the team. Ah, that's right, you're selfish, so you didn't think of that, but I did, because I'm selfless.
No, I feel about that.
Yeah, I know how you feel about it. It reminds me of the time when we were kids at Christmas, and Santa Claus said, "What do you want for Christmas?" And I said, "A name change." And then he said, "I'm going to give it to your brother." And you cried for 4 hours.
Daryl?
If you get in the way of my darts game, you deserve what you get.
I get your hate for Robert. But I think we need to move past her.
Daryl?
Yes.
The one love of my life?
Yes.
The only one whose head I would never put on a dartboard?
Well, that's my concern. You see her every day when you do this 3-hour game.
You say it so condescendingly. three-hour game. This
I
is my life.
I don't remember the last time you spent 3 hours on me. I got a date or something.
No, listen. Hold on a second, Jared. Listen. When a man gets to a certain age.
Now, Daryl.
3 hours in a day.
Daryl.
Reasonable.
I just want to go out and have dinner sometime. I'm sorry.
You want dinner?
Yes. I want a nice dinner without Daryl or Daryl Jr., just us two.
Isn't
yeah,
it enough?
The whole time.
Yeah, we're not listening at the door, Dad.
We didn't hear anything.
Listen, you kids. I'm about to talk bad about you, so I want you to get out from behind the door.
Okay.
Well, I can't get away from them.
Now, to be clear, I meant the other way. I'm about to talk
oh,
bad.
Oh,
about
no.
I think they always bother me while you're playing your darts.
Look, isn't it enough that I promised you that I would make Daryl Jr., the son I clearly loved more to begin with, drop the Jr. moniker?
Well, that's another thing. I think he thinks that you want to be called Robert.
Robert?
Yes.
Do you think I want people to be Robert? That is Robert.
I know you don't want people to be named Robert.
I throw things at her face. I have been throwing an improbable amount of darts at that face.
I think, since you keep so many dartboards with Robert's face on them around the house, he's getting the wrong idea.
What idea is he getting?
That's his mom. It is.
Hey, Dad. You're busy cleaning those darts off of Mom's face?
I got a long day of throwing darts ahead of me.
That is an improbable amount of darts you got there. Some might say you have to carry them in your pockets.
Ever since I got laid off at the steel mill, this is all I have.
Well, that's what I wanted to talk to you about. You know, Dad, if I may.
Daryl, quick.
Oh, well, I was thinking maybe I could start working at the steel mill since they're kicking me out of school.
I see what this is. I get kicked out and now you want in? Well, you're trying to upstage me, son.
It's your standard father-son conflict arc.
Come here. Come here, Daryl.
Okay.
I've always loved you like a son. I've always loved you like a son should be loved. But listen, son, if you cross me on this and I find out you went to the steel mill, that's your future.
Welcome to your first day at the steel mill. My name is Robert.
Very motherly grunt.
Yes, it is. Excuse my voice, I smoke a lot. Speaking of which, you want to smoke?
Smells just like the dartboard Dad uses. Nicotine and carcinogens.
You look familiar.
Yeah, the spitting image of you, some might say. I wouldn't.
You say funny things as well. This orange hair.
Oh, that's runs in the family.
Huh. Anyways, all right. First day steel mill. So explain to me why you are here again.
I want to subvert my father.
Okay. It's
simple conflict resolution bullshit.
Got it. Perfect. Of course you have an education, correct?
More.
We don't judge here. What is the first grade that, what's the last grade that you were in?
Middle school. Just the whole grade of middle school. Seventh-ish grade.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, I'm a little behind. I got kicked out, you know, I had one of those literal schools. It's like, if your name's not Daryl, get the hell out.
Wait, did you say Daryl?
That is a name that many people in this country have. And an improbable amount of people in this county, it would seem.
Oh, that name brings back memories. I once knew a Daryl.
All right, so we're going to need to talk about that new hire. Yeah. So he's nervous. I mean, yeah, okay. Bill from Human Resources. I know you don't see me a lot, but... I keep an eye on you, I keep an eye on what you're doing, and these notes that I have here are telling me that guy guy's no good.
Well, what do you mean he's no good? He's got an education.
I think I'm pretty good.
Sarah, come in here.
Oh, I like getting in here when people yell bad things at me. Something I've done since childhood. All right, what?
Daryl's a hard worker.
I work hard.
It's only been a few hours so far.
Just a few.
But he's done more than if we didn't have him.
I got built enough steel to make a battleship.
And, what family did you say you came from? A hard one?
A hard knocks one.
Yeah.
I'm just coming in for my last check. HR, every time I make those battleships here, you're the only one that I ever felt really connected with. Oh,
that's the most human I get here, down in HR. You know we're kind of scary guys, so here's your check.
Thank you.
Sign here. Just say you picked it up. Thank you.
Yeah, listen, I know this is a weird request. Have you seen someone who looks a lot like me? His name's Daryl. He's probably just made one ship by about this time. Boy, always was a slacker, not like this old man.
Let me see. We hired a new guy, but he's kind of causing some trouble. I'm sure you don't want to hear it.
What's his name?
His name may or may not be Daryl, but I'm sure it's no relation.
Hey, human resources here to pick up my last chip. Okay, you want me to be the dark dwarf? Okay.
Well, this is my office.
I'll turn.
Mom.
Yes, Daryl.
Dad.
Yes, Daryl.
What? Your name's Daryl.
Daryl and Daryl.
Oh, okay. I was confused for a second.
I'm also Daryl, as you remember.
To be clear, we're all Daryl.
Yes.
No further commentary needed.
Okay.
I haven't seen Daryl Jr. in 3 days.
Don't ask about him!
Don't talk about Daryl Jr.
Don't talk about Daryl Jr.
Very sensitive.
Also, there's a bunch of industrial steel in my room.
So your dad gets his paychecks in steel. We all knew this, and he makes darts out of them in his spare time since he got laid off.
Whoa. What's the conversion rate from steel to euros to dollars? Which everyone knows is how you convert steel to U.S. currency.
So don't ask me these questions. You don't want to know the answers.
I do, Papa Daryl.
Look, if you'll get off my case about that, I'll make you what I always promised. I'll make you the real Daryl Jr.
Daryl, take this. He's knocking off.
You can't do this to me, Daryl. I'm Daryl Jr. And if you intruded on this, ignore the dart holes in my face. Listen, I got a bad backside dart hole.
You need to go to a hospital.
Okay, there's blood pouring out of my face. It's fine.
And probable.
Improbable blood everywhere. It's all over the carpet, which is steel plated, incidentally.
I need to take you to the hospital, man.
Okay, just take me to HR. It's infomercial time. We can't get enough of these on real TV, so we're going to sell them to you now. Yes. I need Caroline, I need Grant, I need Hanson, I need Justin, but not in that order because it's Justin, Grant, Caroline, Hanson. I need a product for each group to sell.
Sugar bombs.
What?
Flying lawnmowers.
I hear flying lawnmowers for this group, but if you can't sell that, then nobody's buying. All right, I need another thing to be sold.
Ducks.
You're selling ducks, guys. Hope you can do it. We got flying lawnmowers and ducks. Let's start with ducks.
Hey, Charlene.
Hey, Daniel.
You know what I hate?
Oh, I have an idea.
I hate. Wait. What's your idea?
Just continue.
Oh, okay. I hate not...
Can we try this again? Sorry.
Okay, sure, okay. Hey, Carol...
sad all the time.
Is that right, Carol?
That's right, Johnny. There's this patch of grass growing in the clouds that I can't shake.
I saw that very patch of grass this morning, and I thought, how am I going to get that with my push lawnmower?
I know. It's ruining the property value for our entire neighborhood.
Our neighbors are most unhappy.
There's got to be a better way.
Carol, are you thinking what I'm thinking?
I think I am.
Flying lawnmowers.
That's right. What if your push lawnmower...
The very same?
Simply attach some duck wings.
To be clear, did you say duck wings or ducklings?
I said duck wings, but they're made from ducklings.
And we have a duck. It's
ducks! Ducks!
Hey, Carol, tell me how many times this has happened to you. Oh, I've got $9.99 just burning a hole in my pocket. If only I could spin it on a flying lawnmower.
About once every 2 hours.
Carol, now you're speaking my language, because that's exactly how much our lawnmower costs.
What a great deal! I would have expected $200 at least.
I know what you're thinking. A duck usually costs $9.99. A lawnmower usually costs $9.99? How could a lawnmower covered in duckling duck wings ever cost just $9.99?
I don't know. Beats me.
Carol, how are we doing financially?
I didn't want to tell you this.
Are we okay?
Cut. This is off air.
Ducks.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, proud to introduce... A duck with duckling wings as well. All right.
Our next game is called Help Me Out. What that means is we're going to have two people playing the scene, and we have two other people who are going to be inspiration for them. Anytime Evan and Julia can ask Eamon and Hudson to give them a phrase or a word or something they have to justify as making sense in their scene. Can I get a character relationship for these two?
Presidential
candidates. All right, I like it. Just in time for November. You guys are presidential candidates. Take it away.
You know what, Sean? You're not such a bad guy. You're really not. Like, you know, we were back in fifth grade. I know we had that little quarrel on the swing set, but I'm over it, you know.
I, Caroline, you know, you're so fine.
It's a popular name, I know.
It's a popular name, and you know, you're not such a bad gal either. You know, I know I creamed you in student council, you know, elementary, middle, and high school, but you know, no hard feelings. You know, in fact, I was talking to my counselor today, you know, and they advised me to do this, and you know what he said?
Tell me.
He told me,
"You're gonna make her mincemeat."
He said, "I'm gonna make you mincemeat." Yeah. You know, now I can't cook. But I just got this new stainless steel pot for $9.99, and I'm willing to make this work. Okay.
So you don't necessarily want to make me mincemeat, but you want to make mincemeat with me as like a team.
Exactly. You get it.
Oh, okay. That's nice. I like that you took what your counselor said and kind of saw it as a different light. That's politics, right? That's politics. I mean, you know, back like in 11th grade when I took your prom date, I know that was a little conflicting, but when I talked to my mom about it the other day when I was having a flashback, and she said...
Ha! His old carcass had it coming.
Well,
But in, like, a good way?
Of course.
Like, in the best way.
Of course, in the best way a carcass can be spoken of.
Like, she's not gonna speak ill of her child's, like... enemy turn friends, right?
Right. Mothers care about corpses, you know, obviously. It's standard motherly behavior. You know, in fact, you know, when we were in 12th grade, you know, and I took your chance at winning Homecoming King, as happens, you know.
Yeah, true.
My mom was real proud of me that night, and she said,
"Who would elect Caroline Homecoming King anyway?"
She said, "Who would elect Caroline Homecoming King anyway?" And she kind of has a point.
I mean, you know that I was always trying to change the system. Like, gender is not really, like, out there anymore. It's like, I wanted to be Homecoming King. It's fine, you know. You got it, though. I mean, it was well-deserved. You're a good guy. It made sense at the time, you know. Even though we've moved on, history has changed. I'm not going to give this history lesson. Instead, I'm going to tell you a little something I saw on TV today, and I felt it fitting for our friendship.
Sure.
The commercial said,
"If you make friends with them, you can stab them in the back more easily later."
With love.
This next game is going to be called Tag Team Typewriter, and it's going to be really similar to the game that we played before this year. What's going to happen is Jake and Grant are going to be, well, yes, you too. Jake and Grant are going to be like typing a story here, and Justin and Hans are going to have no choice but to act it out, and that's how it works. Can I get a suggestion for a fictional book title they can write right now? A book that's never been written before.
As I Lay Crying.
As I Lay Crying. Thank you.
All right, James, listen here. Your books suck. I've come because your editor sent me to help you write your next book because that's how bad you are. No, I don't want you to take that harshly, James, because I think you have potential.
Okay.
let's just start writing.
You said a lot of mean things, and I don't know.
No offense. Let's just start writing.
Okay.
It was a day like any other.
Oh, boy. It was a day like any other. A good one. That was a better way to put it.
Okay. More active verbs.
More active verbs. That's right.
Thomathan was enjoying a terse swing upon the maple set that his father bought him before his untimely demise at the hands of communists.
Tomothy's father died. Tomothy did not. The previous wording was unclear. The readers have got to know. They have been wondering. Tomothy decided this would be his time to memorialize his father. Today, the day like any other, where he always memorialized his father. This was his hobby.
His hobby is memorializing his father.
It's cheap and easy to get into.
All right.
He was the only one in town that had this hobby. That was until today, the day like any other, where a person that was a backpacker came along.
The backpacker was a communist. Hello. Western pig.
What are you doing here?
Said Tomothy.
The story just writes itself.
Okay, the communist, knowing fully well that he was communist and Tomothy was not, decided to ridicule him just a bit more.
Communist had not quite mastered the English language, but he was trying. He knew four words: Westorn,
Weston,
pig,
and
mildly French.
Bonjour.
Guy, despite how others might think of him.
He didn't say it, though, because he was staring the Russian communist down with eyes of pure capitalist hatred.
Those eyes.
lesson on gender rights in the whole time?
This took place in the 1950s.
This was information we should have covered in the prologue. Am not for to understanding why you think no half penis means I cannot be father, mother.
The mind reading communist predicted. Prophecies decided, this is a bit odd for his taste. He said, to call out on him, he said, wait, are you sure you read my mind right now? Because you said that I thought you were my mother, and I only thought that. I've never mentioned that previously.
Let's done! The communist had a way of communicating with his face.
He knows
it. So now you've seen everybody play at least one game. Now you're going to see everybody together play a game. We're going to go to the movies. What's going to happen is these two are going to be telling their movie critics. They're going to be talking about a film they recently saw. All of us are going to act out scenes in that film. It's going to be a lot of fun. Can I get a title or a fictional film that we can make together?
The purple bear?
I heard the purple bear first. Own that. That was great. The purple bear. Take it away, you guys.
Daniel. Danathan. Danny Boy. You know we're dating because of your beautiful face.
Super okay.
Yeah, it's very okay. But anyway, so it's my birthday, and it's also our 5-year anniversary. And you know how I like to speak in a breeze. So anyway.
True, but there's no E on the end.
That's right. It's like A B.
Get it? It's T R U. It doesn't read. No.
You're never good at this, Danny. Anyway, what I was trying to say is like propositively, like I don't know, Netflix and chill. There were no I's in those words. I was like, Netflix and chill. Let's watch a movie. Okay. A move. I was thinking something about like colorful, Erskine creatures. Maybe up there.
Grizzly Man?
Listen, we all watched that one. It made our eyes open about bears, but it did not have a happy ending. So I'd rather watch this new one. It's called The Purple Bear. Okay, I'm just gonna hit play. You know, I've seen it already, but I think you'll love it. It starts out where a young man walks into the woods to mate his destiny, and he runs into a camera.
To mate?
Where are you going?
I'm just trying to mate my destiny.
And from the beginning, you know that it's just going good places because he's confused. He says mate, not mate. I didn't say that. What a silly thing for a dumb person to say.
Yeah, but where's the bear?
Oh, wait, we're getting there. The bear sneaks across during the transitions to let you place like Jaws. You don't see the bear until the very end.
Well, there's a lot of really esoteric movies that work in this film.
It was an indie film.
Okay.
Wes Anderson directed it. It was very quirky. But so the park ranger meets this young man who's trying to mate his destiny, and a couple of other campers. Sure.
Now, the funny thing I'm seeing is that since it's a Wes Anderson film, they're all stop-motion foxes, yes?
They are, and there's kind of a sepia-tone filter over the camera the entire time. And all of the characters are played by Tilda Swinton.
I'm here to make my destiny.
Did you say mate?
Yes, sir.
That's quirky.
Randy gets super confused there, but he keeps going anyway.
I feel like I didn't buy with the ranger a lot.
Shut up, Danny.
All right, campers. We're going to take a satchel of quirky items, like a handheld telescope and a bandana.
Oh, boy. We can use my destiny in there?
The ranger forgot his portrait of Edith Piaf at home. So the ranger takes the boys out camping into the most dangerous part of the woods. And this is where it gets really good. Because they meet a wild man.
And his wild wife.
Are you my destiny?
The wild wife was actually the camper that the mating destiny boy ran into earlier.
You?
Jesus.
At this point, you're probably confused. It goes into French subtitles here, but I'll do my best.
Et tu mon destiny.
Tu perds ma destiny.
I have to do it in a French accent.
You said bonjour, which is a fucking French word.
All right, would you like translating? You failed French in high school, so go
tu
ahead.
Tu es orange.
Yeah, you can't fucking do it. Okay, so he says to the wild woman, yeah, I remember running into you, and it was very nice. And, like, I would mate you if you were my destiny, but you're not. And I am a man who respects monogamy.
Because since Wes Anderson, a man from Texas, directed it, this isn't cultural appropriation.
Exactly right. And that's when it gets crazy, because the bear comes and eats the wild woman, and it's just on screen, and the wild man just tries beating him with a bat that he fell on the ground. It doesn't work because it's aluminum, and that is against MLB regulations. It's just a real bad problem there. And so the bear finishes eating the wild woman. The wild man's like, okay, you know what? I think bears are kind of cute because I'm wild and you're wild.
And the old guy from the bears, he's mouthing, he's saying,
are you going to make my destiny? All
right. All right, this next game is going to be called Jekyll and Hyde. But what happens is, Julianne and Hudson are going to be doing a scene. It's a happy scene. It's good things are happening. It's there's sunflowers in the air, and grass needs to be mowed right above the clouds. And then there's also going to be an unhappy scene where something really bad is happening, and we're going to make them go back and forth very quickly. It's going to be a lot of fun. Can I get a session for, like, a good thing that could happen to you? You win the lottery. Okay, that's your Jekyll scene. And what's a bad thing that could be happening?
Someone
slashing tires. So take it away, Jekyll.
I'm gonna win this time. I just know it.
Okay.
5, 5, 5, 6. I got six more.
Okay. Hold on. Let me pull mine out to you. Okay, are you watching?
5, 5, 5, 5. I did it. $10!
Okay. Wait. I want to see what the Powerball is. Okay. Hold on. I need to check mine. Okay. 13. Okay. 14. 27. 103.
I don't know what these numbers mean.
0. Oh my god. I got $15,760.
But we got $15,770.
Oh my gosh, okay. What are we gonna buy first? Like, okay.
So, I think we need to go for the knife first.
Hi.
That way, we can get into the tires easily.
Okay, well, I didn't just buy these gloves that have slashers on them.
Oh my god.
I know they've been on your Amazon wish list.
Oh my god!
I could only buy them as one pair.
It's okay, we can share.
I know, watch out, be careful. Okay. Yes. You feel the power?
You know me so well!
Jekyll!
Well, Lisa.
$10! In coins!
In coins, yeah.
Where's your, like, whatever, large amount of money?
Well, I'm getting them in increments because the gas station didn't have enough coins.
Oh, okay.
So.
Well, I'm going to roll these up. Do you need help rolling up your, how much did you get?
I only got $7 in coins because you had the majority.
You actually got 9.
Oh, look at you, my gal pal.
Yeah.
Hi.
I'm sorry, I had to take both of them. Like, I know you were sleeping.
My hands are nude now.
I had to feel the power in both of them.
Please don't tell me you went out and slashed cars without me.
Oh, I
How am I supposed to trust you as my wife if I can't even trust you as my partner in crime?
Jekyll.
I'm out of my $10.
Well?
I spent it all on chocolate gold coins.
You spent your real money on fake money.
I have 10 $1 chocolate gold coins. Actually, I only have 8 because I gave you that $2 earlier. 6, I ate 2 of them.
Yeah. I watched you. I watched as the chocolate melted in your hands, just like all of your dreams.
What about you? You've been getting $7 every month. How are you doing?
Well, I'm doing fine because I'm trying to save up for that nice KitchenAid mixer I've been telling you about for the past month.
Well, I would buy it for you if I still had my $8. But you didn't tell me about it.
Was I supposed to tell you about my thing? What if you bought the same thing as me?
I'm just trying to be a good friend for you.
Okay, I'm gonna need you to lay off the whiskey.
Hi.
What are you doing now?
I was redecorating our walls.
I got my own pair of slashers.
Okay, well. Oh, you think that's funny? That
yeah,
my claws were stuck in our wall.
I think it's a comedy routine.
Okay. So you wanna...
I feel like if you went out and slashed cars with those things, people would just laugh instead of being horrified at your freaky scissor hands.
Okay, well, yours look pretty much the exact same as mine, except they're
but
purple.
They're purple!
Let's see! They're purple!
Alright! Now, we have this fun little game coming up. It's called Oscar Winning Moments. And for that, I need Evan, I need Justin, and I need to look at this one.
It's me!
It's
Caroline!
It's Caroline. Alright, so how this game works is I need a title of a movie that doesn't exist and it's not Shrek 6. But no, yeah, just a movie title that does not exist.
A series of fortunate events.
Frozen Dogs. And so what's going to happen is these three are going to perform Frozen Dogs, but at any given minute, I'm going to say Oscar-winning moment, and they're going to come out, and they're going to perform a monologue that is worthy of an Oscar. So let's take it away. Frozen Dogs.
And if you look here, you'll see we have another one, a dog, just frozen in place. We don't know how it happened. We don't know anything about it.
When I signed up to be an ice archaeologist, I didn't realize it was going to be this sad.
No, when I married an ice archaeologist, I didn't think it was going to be this sad.
One second.
It'd take all the time you need.
Yeah, please. Honey?
Yes?
What's that?
I'm frozen dog.
I get what that is.
How could you?
She's gonna kick over my marriage like I kick over that dog? Sure, yeah. Whatever, I'm the bad guy here.
You don't have to hurt canines just because your marriage is
well,
frozen.
Well, it is frozen and dead, so.
You seem like a little aggressive. Did you take your medicine this morning?
My aggressive pills? I did. I didn't think you were asking.
Good. Let's try to put a little more of a pleasant tone on
okay.
In front of other people.
Oscar winning moment, Evan.
Going to an icy theme park for marriage counseling was not such a good idea. In retrospect, we should have gone to Disneyland. Now I'm stuck here with these two people, and I think I might push them into the ice to freeze them too.
So, what's next on the tour?
We've got some great sculptures for you to see.
Hey, you want to know what a sculpture of an ice queen would look like?
That's so sweet. I love when you refer to me as queen.
She's got a point there. If you want to see real queens, they're in here. This is Elizabeth.
I think that was a queen.
I think a few, honestly.
So I've heard all of our education comes from YouTube. They can't afford to train us. So,
Oscar-winning moment, Justin.
Oh, boy. This is just so weird because I'm married to her, but I love him. I do. I came here with my wife for marriage counseling to this amusement park. Ice archaeologist, I thought that this is going to be perfect, but quickly I felt a spark. It's the only warmth in this entire freezing park. The spark I feel for this man. But here's the problem. He thinks I'm unavailable because, I don't know, I'm married or whatever. So I have to constantly make moves towards that direction by insulting my wife and complimenting our wonderful guide.
Well, that's pretty interesting. How long has she been present?
Couple of decades?
Wow, you're like so smart.
But I try. You know, it's that's our best scientific guesstimations.
Yeah, I got this. Yeah. So what's next on the tour?
Oscar-winning moment, Caroline.
There's something strange going on. I'm not really sure what to do, but I was planning on filing for divorce last week, but then he started becoming really sweet and nice, and he brought me to this amusement park, and it just kind of like reinforced my love for him, so I just feel really lucky to have found such an amazing man.
Well, no.
Old favorite, it's called interrogation. What's going to happen is, Tucker here, he killed somebody. We all knew he would do it. The only question is, who did he kill, what did he kill him with, and where did he kill them? So we sent him away, we're going to make sure that he's got his fingers in his ears, so he can't hear a word we say. Who do you guys think would be a good person for Tucker to have killed?
Jamie Jackson!
Jamie
Jackson!
Donald Trump!
Sorry, who?
Samuel Jackson.
That's how we yes and people. Yeah, Samuel Jackson, of course he murdered. What murder weapon did he use for Samuel Jackson?
A spoon.
Go for it, yeah. He killed with a spoon. And where did he kill him?
In the Valley of Israel.
Space.
Aleppo.
The country of
what? Mosul. More places.
A plane.
Cincinnati Zoo.
We've already done the Cincinnati Zoo. Sorry, what? McDonald's, sure, yeah. He killed Samuel L. Jackson, did it with a spoon, did it at McDonald's, all right? You guys ready for this? Let's bring him in here.
I have some fresh meat here. They gotta rock you up. You gonna die?
Yeah. I think he knows a little too much about our proceedings.
Foiled again. Just got caught again. Once again, I've ended up in prison. Shawshank, to be precise. Anyway, I suppose I'll let you continue on with your interrogation. Go ahead. If you must, have at me. I've gotten out of prison before, and I'll do it again. I'll crawl through a mile of shit to get there. And I'll meet my friend, Andy Dufresne. Anyway, I like monologuing. Where are you?
We know you like to be in a lot of jails, similar to someone who likes to be in almost every movie.
Yeah.
Oh.
You may think you're a plain old criminal, but I think you're a snake.
Well, the snake kind of contradicts the God thing, but all right. As you were saying.
As I was saying, yes,
You travel around jails because you kill a lot of people, but this person that we're trying to find out who you killed is very important. Do you see what I'm saying?
English. Do you speak it?
Well, I'm feeling kind of hungry. Can I brought a burger really quick. You know,
take your time.
I love royals with cheese.
Can you ask me, can you help me pick up that wallet? The one that says, bad motherfucker! I didn't say you could have this! I'm tired of your motherfucking antics! I'm tired of your mother...
You're being really vulgar. And like, I get it. But like, when I tell you who it was, when I do it, you're gonna spray me with mace when I do it, mace. Oh, you got it. All right. That's good, because Samuel L. Jackson deserved to die. He used the F word too much. I just don't like that.
Even if you don't like it, sometimes you gotta live with it, because important people in your life enjoy the word. You know what?
You're new at this, aren't you?
I've gone through so many Smarties.
Is he like the kid detective or something?
He sure is. Listen.
Didn't expect that affirmative of an answer, I'm sorry.
I apologize for my vulgar language. So instead of saying, I'll just start saying fork, okay?
Right.
Stop forking around with us.
I feel like it's implied what you're saying.
Friend, can I talk to you for a moment?
One second, I'm sorry.
Listen, you can't go going soft on this guy. We have the scoop on him. He can't dig himself out of this. There's no, like, not a way for him to get out of these proceedings, is what I'm saying.
Well, I got out of the handcuffs, so...
That's only step one.
Your bailiff didn't fasten them, so it was really easy.
Are you gonna, let's crack this guy like some fresh ice cream.
I'm sorry. Did you just say you were going to crack some ice cream? let me see one of them Smarties.
My freezer's a little old.
Fair enough.
Listen, we know you're a serial killer. Just tell us, what did you use?
Well, what can I say? We got in a fight over who was going to be Big Spoon and who was going to be Little Spoon. I just made like a real person and spooned him to death. But that would be if I did it. Now you have to know where, of course.
That's true. We do have to know where.
A likely story, criminal.
You're skipping judge, jury, and executioner on that one. But go ahead, smarty boy.
I like that.
You would.
You hear that? Let's get away from Gumshoe and start calling me smarty boy.
I'm still gonna call you Gumshoe.
I like him.
I don't.
Clearly.
So listen. I know of this farmer who knew Samuel Jackson really well.
Yeah.
And they had a famous song out.
Yeah.
That went E-I-E-I-O.
Yeah. You may have made Samuel Jackson buy the farm, but this guy had it.
You think crime is funny? I think it's quite humorous.
You think you're a clown?
I'm not clowning around.
We're gonna fry him. Metaphorically. But also potentially literally.
starting to like you now.
Yeah. So, these smarties are doing something to me. Something new.
Now police brutality is hilarious. All right, I'm done scolding you. I figure one good scowl is enough. But anyway, we were saying about this location. So, you know, in Europe, they call it a royale with cheese, as we were saying earlier. But, well, I suppose here in the States, where we use that customary system, they call it a quarter pounder with cheese.
Yeah?
Well, no matter where you go, they still call it a Big Mac. I killed Samuel L. Jackson with a spoon at McDonald's.
We're going to do one long form set and get you out of here. This is how this is going to work. Hanson is a front desk clerk at a hotel. These people here are a bunch of wacky people that are in town for some kind of convention. What's the convention? Maybe a convention that doesn't already exist. I'm sorry, what? What did you say? What kind of convention? Villain convention? Yeah, just the villain convention. I like that so much. I'm sorry I had to make you say that three times. I don't hear well. All right, take it away, you guys. Villain convention.
Ah, good evening, sir.
Hello.
Are you here for the convention?
Yes. Dr. Bubbleheimer.
Dr. Bubbleheimer, I've got you on the second floor.
You may have heard of my exploits.
Not mis- okay. Hi, how are you doing tonight?
Hello, I am Thomas Stevenson III.
Stevenson.
Stevenson.
That's a TH or a...
Yes, you know how to spell words.
All right, I've got you on...
Oh, I've already got it.
Okay. I don't know if it's activated.
Hello.
Hi. Are you here to check in for the convention?
I am.
Wonderful.
My name is Cindy Lewis.
Lewis. Wonderful. Here you are.
Thank you. Do you want a Muppet?
Sure.
Okay. I have it in my pocket. I wouldn't eat all of it at once.
Hey. I'm the mechanical destroyer.
Got you in the penthouse suite. Have a nice evening, destroyer. Oh, how are you doing tonight?
Oh, hello.
Are you here to check in for the convention?
The villain convention, yep.
All right, and your last name, please. Shelly. Look, got you right here.
Penthouse?
Actually, it's on the fourth floor today.
Damn kids. Don't watch me. Sorry.
Excuse me.
Yes.
You may recall me as Dr. Bubbleheimer.
Of course, Dr. Bubbleheimer. What can I do for
you? I awoke this morning in the Palace of Bubbles, as the world will soon be, to find many of my bubble machines had gone missing. Popped, as it were.
Okay, if you'd like, we can probably check the security footage on it.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I require bubble making machines.
It does look like somebody. I'm so sorry. This typically doesn't happen.
He's got very supple limbs.
You know, I was not expect. Yeah, you know, I'll have a talk. I'll have a talk with this guest.
You had better before I pop him.
A policy would say, please don't hurt other kids. Okay.
Ding!
Oh, wonderful. I was actually on my way to come talk to you.
Ah, where are you now? I,
About what, exactly?
It seems that we've caught you stealing.
Caught me? Thomas Stevenson.
I know. At first I didn't quite believe it either, but... Well, the tapes.
Oh, you have tapes. Where are they exactly?
So if you watch right here, it shows you very clearly just taking it. And in fact, I've got a few others over here as well. Well, yeah, hold these real quick for me. And yeah, it's real clear that.
I'm sorry, you were saying.
Well, I was just saying it's real clear that you've been stealing from the doctor.
Speaking of doctor, you know, footage can be doctored quite easily, so I doubt that's my face on those tapes.
I never even thought of that.
I think you should check out that mechanical destroyer fella. He seems rather suspicious in the way that he walks, as if he's got a lot of stolen items on him.
You're right! Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. I hope I didn't offend you.
No. All in good faith.
Okay, well... Mechanical destroyer. Just the human thing I was looking for.
I have a problem.
Well, it's like a... Well, okay, sure. You tell me your problem first.
There are no power generators in my cell room.
Oh. You like this one? Is that all you need? Or?
Yes.
Have you been stealing?
All items are belonging to Mechanical Destroyer.
Unfortunately, it does seem like the mechanical destroyer. Oh, let me put you on hold. Hi, how can I help you?
Hello. So I have a situation. So my room is lovely.
Wonderful.
Just the bed was made so nicely, but there's not enough poison in there.
Shampoo? I've got conditioner too. But poison is. that's a little out of my range.
This will be fine.
Wonderful. Did you want a power generator too? Mr. Stevenson.
Yes, hello. I was wondering if you might happen to have information on one of the guests. Even though I'm the thief.
You're what?
The
Stevenson.
Yes, that's my family tree.
Sure.
It's a very distinguished branch, you might. My heart has been stolen by this young lady, Cindy.
How romantic!
You! Did someone say Sydney?
Be still, my heart.
Hi.
I'll let you two be alone.
Okay. Hi. I think we met on the elevator the other day.
I think we did. You're the only other person who uses it. Everyone else takes the stairs.
Hell, right?
It's weird. Why worry about it? I say. Do you like bubbles?
I do like bubbles.
Do you like blowing bubbles?
Yes. Do you like blowing bubbles? Excuse me. I was just wondering if this kind sir would mind helping me up the stairs! Oops.
I don't promote violence against the elderly, but sometimes it's necessary.
The Destroyer. You, come back to return to bubble machines?
Negative. There appears to be an error.
Okay, well, what seems to be the error?
None here match my power.
What?
I must seek and destroy the strongest.
Okay, that sounds like a lot of insurance money. How about a complimentary breakfast? I've got a coupon right here for you. Okay, no, that's fine. you wanna destroy big things. Okay. How about I can arrange something for you. Maybe in the pool or basement. And,
excuse me. Destroying servos engaging.
Whoa, wait, not yet.
Mr. Destroyer, I have proposition for you.
Speak now.
That I will do soon. A man who came, he steals my bubble machines. This ineffective mopper.
Okay.
He holds no role in society.
Okay, wow.
He is useless. You have power. I'm glad we agree. We kill the thief guy with the long, supple limbs.
Changing primary directive.
I like your style. Goodbye, useless mop.
No, you're not useless, okay? You're not useless.
I really, really like blowing bubbles with you.
I rather enjoy
this
it myself.
It's pretty fun.
I've never known a bubble to be so solid to be able to hold it. Is this a new kind of bubble?
They're, you know, fresh out of the market, so.
Oh, don't mind me, I'm just mopping. It's so cute.
Is it flavored?
Yes. Great.
How did you know that was my favorite?
I had a feeling.
Can I?
Yeah. I'm a little concerned. I heard that there's someone here at the villain convention who just pops everyone's bubbles.
Who might that be? We should find him before he pops our bubbles and tries to do away with the machines.
Okay. Oh.
Yes. My good, did you just pry apart the elevator doors?
Affirmative.
We have found you. Step aside, small person. Not you, you are big. Now, I am the machine destroyer.
The mechanical destroyer.
The mechanical
rightful ruler of all the earth.
That's we came circumstance. To reclaim bubbles and bubble machines. Use them peacefully.
I don't believe there's a copyright on bubbles. I think they're owned by everybody.
You don't know a thing about bubbles. You don't know a thing about things. You just take them.
I've blown many bubbles in my lifetime. I'll have you know, I've blown more.
Mechanical Destroyer does not understand bubbles.
Bubbles are universal. They speak to all of us.
Error!
They fly. They shine. They pop. As do we.
No. What have you done?
Mechanical Destroyer.
Well, crap.
Mechanical Destroyer.
Hey.
Hello?
In the absence of Mechanical Destroyer, can I have my bubble machines back?
Rebooting! Rebooting!
Oh, thank you.
We want to thank you so much. much for coming out tonight. I mean it when I say it, we could not do this without you. So if you guys weren't here giving suggestions, we would just talk and no one would listen. Thank you so much for being here. We hope you had a great time with us. Our next date is December the 2nd. Same time, same place. Union Theater at 8:30. All that said, thank you so much. You guys have been a great audience. Have a great night. I've been Bert Macklin.
I'm Justin.
I'm Justin.
I'm Justin Williford.
I'm Justin.
I'm Justin Williford.
Justin Williford.
I'm Justin Williford.
I'm Justin Williford.
I'm Justin Williford.
I'm Justin Williford.
They're a bunch of jerks. We're Loud Chicken Fiddle. Have a great night.